the students some another understanding on Islamic banking practices in terms of theoretical part or application and others. So we do invite some guest lectures. One of you, one of these guest lectures are you. And then we wish that the topic that you will be delivered today is going to give the students more understanding on what the current challenges and issues concerning the Islamic banking, particularly in Malaysia, perhaps, and also in general. Okay, Prof and dear participants, before we start, I would like to just introduce a bit of our guest lecturer today. So basically, Prof Mansur is my lectures and my former lectures at International Islamic University Malaysia last 10 years. I took his course and then quite enjoyed the moments 10 years ago. Time goes very fast. And then now Prof Mansur is the Deputy President Academic and Dean of School of Graduate Studies in SAIF. Yeah, I think some of you already known about this prominent university in Malaysia, that INSAIF is the Global University of Islamic Finance. And Professor Mansur basically received his PhD in economics from Washington University in 1996. And he teaches mostly quantitative, such as mathematics, econometrics, and is the expert on this area. I think some of the audience here and students read so many papers that has been written by him regarding with the issue of banking, finance, and other issues. And Prof. Mansur today will be sharing with us the topic that quite challenging and then quite interesting, namely in the area of digital era. So if I give you just a bit introductions, dear students and participants, that in Indonesia right now, particularly in the under President of Joko Widodo, has a big vision in the digital economic sectors. And the president and the government is targeting Indonesia in 2020 to become the largest digital economic power in ASEAN, with e-commerce transactions and also with the higher populations. Yeah, so this is the potential that will be boost the digital transformation and digital developments in Indonesia. However, this digital transformation will be giving the disruptions because the opportunities and challenges of the banking itself that may be not quite ready to face this outstanding challenge. So some regulation has been given, that has been promoted by the government in order to regulate this this digital transformations, particularly in Islamic banking. So today we are going to look at and listen together from Prof. Mansur that what are the real challenges and what the really problem that will be facing by the Islamic banking in particular in facing this digital transformation or digital era. With that, just a bit introductions, I'm pleased to welcome and invite our professors, Professor Mansur Ibrahim. Time is yours, Prof. Maybe 1 hour is okay, Prof, for okay. Your speech.
Yeah, let's see. Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya wal mursaleen. Wa ala alihi wa man tabi'ahu bi ihsanin ila yamiddin. Dr. Dimas and lecturers, professors at University Muhammadiyah and all the students. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
And first, thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I really feel honored to be invited to give my view on challenges faced by Islamic banking in the digital era. So it's not an easy topic, and I do not think that I can do all the justice with what is happening right now, especially the accelerations of virtual banking or digital banking during the years of pandemics, right? And in fact, some people say that the pandemic itself is catalyst for most of the institutions, including banking, to adopt basically digitalizations, right? So what I would do here, I will emphasize more on Islamic banking, and I will give a little bit of my views in terms of challenges. And you will see that challenges is not new in the context of what Islamic banking is facing, right? So let me share my slide, and later on I will, inshallah, send my slide to Dr. Dimas so that you can have this slide. So,
Sorry for the audience and students. I think Prof. Mansur has quite not stable networks, so he's out of the Zoom automatically. So we are waiting for his join again. So in the meanwhile, please, students and participants, you can prepare your best questions and maybe comments and feedbacks. Okay, Prof. Or maybe you need some help from us, Prof, in order to share your screen here.
I can share the screen. Look, there is a cut off in terms of the internet because now we work from home, right? And sometimes that doesn't happen. So basically, what let me continue. The first thing we discuss a little bit regarding Islamic financial system. These are kind of, for all the students, maybe a refresher for you. Why? Because I think you are in the area and you know exactly what is Islamic financial systems and the principles of Islamic finance and so on. But these are just a refresher for us because we have to understand the context, the rules of Islamic banking in the economy for us to be able to appreciate the challenges, right? So I will discuss first the Islamic financial systems, right? The way that I see it, right? From someone who are researching on Islamic banking. Right? I have not worked in Islamic banking, but I write some article regarding Islamic banking with respect to the performance and challenges of Islamic banking. And then I will touch in general the roles of banks. What are the role of banks in the economy? Right? Why I would like to touch on this? Because the emergence of Islamic banking itself is to fulfill certain roles that are played by conventional banks. And in fact, not to fulfill, to replace conventional bank in basically the achieving whatever the objective of the banking system. So I have to discuss a little bit of the roles of bank, and normally the role of bank is discussed in the money and banking basically class, for example. So I will just inform you a little bit on this part, right? And then I will add into my discussions. These are the role of banks, right? And Islamic banks come in participating in the provisions of the banking services, right? But according to the Sharia. Right? But then the promise of Islamic banking is basically, I would put the word here, inclusive growth, right? And I'll try to define a little bit what it means by Islamic banking and promises in the context of promoting what we term as inclusive growth, right? So I will try to bring up the context of the 2015 United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. So that are very important developments where Islamic banking has been viewed to provide platforms or to be the an important player, especially in Muslim countries, to promote financial inclusion and in the process promote inclusive growth. Right? So these are three points that I would like to put into the context, right, for us to evaluate what I term as or evaluate the challenges or opportunities faced by Islamic banking. And then I will discuss a little bit on disruptions. And then again, something that we know, but this disruption itself had brought up what we term as the digital era, the industrial revolution 4.0 that we have gone through, phase one, the IR 1.0, 2.0, 3.0. Now we are at 4.0. where industrial revolution 4.0 is based on the cyber systems, where the process of exchanges are taking place through the cyberspace. Right? So I will discuss a little bit in terms of industrial revolution 4.0, and then just give a little bit example of basically the race toward digital banking. Right? And digital banking in Malaysia, for example, right? And the central bank in Malaysia, for example, have provided basically the guideline for applying for the licenses for digital banking. And similarly, in the context of Indonesia, for example, I think I'm not sure it is out or not, but then based on the news earlier of the years, basically the guideline for digital banking will be provided in the mid of the year 2021. So those are the topic that we'll try to touch a little bit in the context of bringing in disruptions or digitalizations and how this pose challenges, right, to banking, more specifically Islamic banking. And as I mentioned, the challenges is not something new, right? But digital banking perhaps can provide opportunities, right, for Islamic banking to address the existing challenges. So that's the way that I see it in the context of Islamic banking taking the opportunity, for developing itself within the Islamic financial systems and play the functions, play the roles and fulfill the promises, as what I term the promise of Islamic banking is to promote inclusive growth. So I will end up with few challenges, and then I think we can discuss. But in the context of challenges, there are a lot of challenges. If you go through, for example, a lot of write-up that has been done by many people, they have put all kinds of challenges. I would like to put here very basic challenges of Islamic banking that in the establishments of what I term as the holistic or integrated Islamic financial systems. So that my plans for my presentations in the context. I hope that it will not be too high in terms of contents, and I hope it's not be too low or too easy in terms of contents, but then something that we can think about, right? As students, for example, is the future leaders, as students of Islamic banking or Islamic economics, we are expected to go out, right, to make changes, to be the agent of changes for the betterments of society, right? Because in the context of what we learn in Islamic economics, for example, Islamic economics is based on basically the societal welfare taking precedence basically should be the priority as opposed to individual welfare. So those are thing that we have been taught. As a result, right, when we see the challenges, what we see here, I think for us to understand this and to push Islamic banking forward. Right? Now, if we look at, right, in one of the chapters that I wrote, hopefully coming up this year, in the context of what we term as, right, Islamic financial systems, right, we look at, I define Islamic financial systems to comprise of a set of institutions as well as market, right? As well as markets. So you have institutions like banking institutions, the government institutions in there, particularly for Malaysian case, for example, would be Securities Commissions of Malaysia, would be Central Bank of Malaysia. Right? And then for the case of Indonesia would be OJK as well as the Bank Indonesia, for example. These are a set of institutions and markets, right? And particularly the market that basically manage the flow of funds, right? The flow of funds from those who have financial surpluses, right? From those who have financial surpluses to those who basically need funds, either for the purpose of consumptions or for the purpose of investments. So we have the markets. Right? So you have the players in the systems and you have the market in the system, right? In terms of the whole or integrated financial system or Islamic financial system. Now, normally in the discussions of Islamic financial systems, right? Early discussions, I think if we want to go back to the early 1940s or 1930s, 40s, 50s, for example, where in those years we have the early thinkers, these early Islamic thinkers, right, try to propagate the establishment of Islamic banking or Islamic financial system with the sole objective of basically the abolishing the interest-based system, right? So that Muslims can basically apply the Sharia for the purpose of their financial transactions. So if we look at the way that literature have discussed, we focus a lot on financial intermediaries. So the first focus that we have is on banking, right? And then with the interest that many Muslims have on investments, right? The guideline has been made to classify those listed firms into Sharia compliance. And we have basically Sharia compliance stocks, right? And then we have basically the issuance of sukuk, and that form what I term as capital markets or the financial market. So that the early part of looking at the Islamic financial system. But when we look at Islamic financial system, for example, in the context of what we have done before in the early part, these systems are based on, or we term these institutions as business financial institutions. Right? They are in offering the products in accordance with the Sharia, but they have business objective, right? Which is basically they have stakeholders, right? And they have shareholders where the managers or the agents, basically those who run the banks or those who run investments, right, for example, have the objective of maximizing returns for the benefit of shareholders or stakeholders, right? But this is only one half of Islamic financial systems, right? As more and more the recognitions of the importance of inclusive growth, right, of importance of inclusive growth, or the with the inceptions of the 17 goals, right, of SDG, right, or what we term as sustainable development goals, more recognitions have been given to what we term as social financial institutions. And in fact, in some literature, for example, they make distinctions between what we term as business financial institutions and social financial institutions, right? So you have Islamic banking, Islamic capital markets, and in terms of social financial institutions, we have Zakat institutions, we have Awqaf institutions, and so on. Right? And in Malaysia, for example, Zakat institution is under the state governments, and in Indonesia, you have your own Zakat institutions and Awqaf institutions. And also we have Hajj institutions, right? But the way that the market or the institutions are linked, right? They are not operating. We should not view Islamic financial system to be composed of two segments, one social, one business, and the two segments are working independently. No, the Islamic financial system are the whole integrated system that link both, which means that even the business financial institutions have to play the roles in terms of provide social services to society. either directly, which means participating directly or indirectly through zakat institutions or through awqaf institutions. So there must be integration between these two for us to establish, for example, the fully, to my opinion, Islamic, the full Islamic financial systems. Otherwise, it will not be complete. Now, if we look at the many countries, for example, right? If we look at many countries, we cannot say that we already have the fully established Islamic financial systems, right? Because in some countries, they are good in one aspect, but they are not so good in the other aspects, right? For example, in Malaysia, for example, we are good in Islamic banking, right? But then we still have a lot of problems, even if we have awqaf institution, we still have a lot of problem in terms of managing awqaf and so on, where the benefits basically of awqaf, of awqaf or of wakaf, for example, have not reached whoever those awqaf has targeted, right? So we have a problem there, and awqaf institutions sometimes is less integrated to the banking system. If you look in the context of Turkey, for example, they have a good awqaf institutions, but then their Islamic banking still less than 10% in terms of market share. So we do not have a fully integrated Islamic financial system yet. So this is what I term as Islamic financial system must consist of the integrations of both business financial institutions and social financial institutions, right? And I'm not going to go through basically the Islamic finance principle, because I think you have understood well, but I think you have been trained well in the context of what are the principles of Islamic finance, right? Prohibitions of riba, the avoidance of gharar, or extreme uncertainty, profit and loss sharing, and mutual assistance, and exclusions of forbidden activities, and so on. I'm not going to discuss in details, right? The only thing that I would like to basically encourage you is this, right? Because if we look at the discourse or the discussions regarding Islamic banking in particular, or Islamic financial system in particular, for example, there are basically two groups or two diverging opinions. There, one opinion tries to promote Islamic banking as much as possible with the belief that Islamic banking brings the Islamic dimensions of Islamic financial transactions to society and can bring benefits. The other view basically is quite skeptical of Islamic banking, and that's why I think the same in Malaysia as well as the same in Indonesia, we have some that view Islamic banking or Islamic finance is not Islamic, right? So that common term discussion, is nothing wrong in that. But then for me, for example, I would encourage you as a future Islamic economist or Islamic finance practitioners, for example, right, not to look at basically the weaknesses or the negative. I'm not going to say negative side, but I would say more weaknesses, because something that has been developed, it takes time, right? 20 years, 30 years, it's not a long period. You cannot make it to be a totally 100% complete Islamic, but then we have to work forward, right? We have to work forward in terms of completing the whatever we have not completed, right? In context of Islamic finance, right? In the same way that I would say, if the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have been sent to complete a deen, for example, right? To complete basically the Islam itself. Right. Let us, for example, because we are in this area, let work to complete Islamic finance, right, without basically being skeptical about Islamic finance. And if something wrong, we promote the models that can basically bring the Islamic principles. Right. So it's coming back. These are the whole Islamic systems, Islamic financial system that we can see. So we cannot look at Islamic financial system as just Islamic banking or Islamic crypto market. There are parts, but then these parts are interconnected. They have to be integrated together. So that's basically the systems or the Islamic financial system that I would like to define in this context. Right? Now, when we look at, for example, the role of banks, right? I would like to focus specifically on banks, right? Because our topic is on the banking, one portion of the system. But please keep in mind that bank is just one institutions within the Islamic financial systems, and in many countries, it appears to be the most dominant portions of Islamic financial system, but then it may not be the one that contribute the most to societal welfare, right? But the most prominent right now, because many countries are promoting Islamic banking. Now, what are the role of Islamic banking, right? And role of banks in general? I think what we have learned basically in the context of the role of banks, for example, is intermediations. And that's what we have learned, kind of basic intermediations. Islamic banking or banks in general take deposits and then intermediate that to deposit, which means channel those deposits of funds that they raise through deposits to those who need funds, right? For the financing of working capital, investments, consumptions, trade, and so on, right? So that's the function of banks, right? But you have to remember that banks basically do more work, right, rather than intermediations, right? The most important part regarding Islamic banking is basically they have what we term as economies of scale in processing informations, right? So basically they process informations, right? Just take a look at without banking, what would happen? And without banking, what would happen? And just imagine all of us have extra funds to invest, but there's no banking there, right? So every single one of us, and let's say it's no capital market, every single one of us basically try to gather information. So we try to do exactly the same thing. So which is costly, right? Everyone try to gather information about firm ABC, for example, right? Everyone try to gather information about firm XYZ, right? So everyone do exactly the same functions. There are duplications of functions in terms of information processing, and that is costly to society, right? So banks coming in, right, perform that functions, right? And what we need to do, just put money in the bank, and bank perform that functions, and that reduce what we term as transaction costs, very important parts, right? Because everyone need not invest in information gathering, information processing before they invest in any particular project, because now bank will take your place and all other people places in order to process information. And that really important parts, right? Banks provide you diversification of risk, right? Imagine you have 1,000 USD, for example, you want to invest on your own, for example, you may not be able to invest in many, many sectors because of the small size of your investments. But bank pool those funds together, small depositors, for example, and then take those funds, invest in various sectors, right? So it's basically provide you what we term as diversification benefits, right? If I have $1,000, for example, if I want to invest, I may be able to invest in only in one company, right? Let's say through capital market, right? But if I put in bank take all small depositors together with all big depositors and then allocate those funds to many sectors, right? To manufacturing, to mining, to agriculture, to oil and gas, and so on. So banks diversify for you. And that's what we term as diversification for risk. And banks also perform the function to monitor for you in terms of the projects that they put in. So they provide monitoring services. So these are big functions of the bank, right? And when you think in terms of this case, Islamic bank also have this function that they have to play, right? Because Islamic bank cannot just intermediate according to Sharia principles. Islamic bank also have to assess the risk. Islamic bank also have to diversify. Islamic bank also have to gather information regarding the client, regarding the firm, regarding the project, so that the money that has been put into the banks by depositors are used optimally or are channeled efficiently to those projects that can give higher returns, right? And emphasize higher return for the fact that bank is business financial institutions, but that bank provide that services, right? And we know that Islamic banking emerged and becomes quite rapid in the context of its progress from early years, right? And now, the last time I checked, for example, there are basically 13 countries that Islamic banking can be considered as systematically important or significant, which means they have a market share of 15%. And Indonesia is moving toward that direction with a lot of new Islamic banking come into the picture, either through conversions of, right, of the early conventional banks that have been acquired by certain banks, or through, for example, the spin-off of Windows and become subsidiaries. So Indonesia is moving forwards. And in fact, there are a lot of rooms for Indonesia to progress, given the fact that this is the largest Islamic banking market on earth, right? With the Muslim populations there, basically Islamic banking has a lot of role to play, right? And these are the role of banks, where Islamic bank have also to play. But then Islamic banking also have the promises, right? Going back to the basic principles, mutual assistance, for example, right? Exclusions of something that can bring harm to others, for example, Islamic bank have what I term as the promises that that they give to society with the establishments of Islamic banking, right? Now, when I say Islamic banking, right, have a promise to play, the promise of Islamic banking is basically it have to serve as mechanisms, it have to serve as a catalyst for inclusive growth, right? Which I define roughly in the context of the inclusive growth, promoting growth, right? Protections of equality of fairness and mitigations of harms, right? Which means that the growth that have taken place, right, through the services provided by Islamic banks, intermediation services provided by Islamic banks must be inclusive. They must be inclusive, which means that there should not be big disparity in terms of income distributions when you have Islamic financial systems, right? And then the use of resources should not be at the expenses of future generations, right? In the context of prevention of harms, and especially the, with respect to the environmental degree problems, right? The pollutions and environmental problems. So Islamic banking can provide basically a mechanisms to inclusive growth through various aspects, right? And I term this one as the growth channels in the context of promoting inclusive growth. Islamic banking is basically provide us with or promoting what we term as financial inclusions. And I think if you look and you read a lot of research that has been done on financial inclusions, for example, right, evidence coming up, right, more and more evidence coming up that financial inclusions mitigate the cycles. Financial inclusions basically reduce income inequality, right? And financial inclusions promote economic growth, right? Financial inclusions promote economic stability. A lot of work has been done, right? And then in one of the articles by the IMF or the World Bank, right? I think the World Bank suggests that in Muslim countries, Islamic banking can play that role of financial inclusions, right? And Islamic banking is efficient in the context of provide a direct link between real and finance connectivity, right? And if you look at, for example, in the context of conventional finance, for example, right? In conventional finance, right, based on the book that has been published by Bank Indonesia, I think through Department's Economy dan Kawangan Syariah, I think DEKS, I'm not mistaken, based on the book that has been published last year on Islamic monetary systems, right? In that book, right, it explained that in the context of conventional banking, the conventional financial instruments can develop on its own and become the market of its own without any connections with the real sector, and become the market of its own where they have demand and supply and become highly speculative. If you look at in the context of debt market, in the context even the stock market, right, to a certain extent, securitization of debt and so on, right, where the activities of what you observe, for example, in the conventional banking system doesn't reflect what happens in the real sector. But in the context of Islamic banking, because of that real finance connectivity, they are closely connected, because any financing must be supported by basically real assets, right, or real sector activities. So Islamic banking is provide basically what we term as financial efficiency, right? And also Islamic banking tend to promote financial stability, not only because of a stronger governance frameworks, because now Islamic banking not only have normal board, but also Sharia boards, but also because of the prohibitions of certain type of assets, which are considered to be toxic and which are viewed to basically contribute to the global financial crisis, right? Like those securitizations, debt instruments, and so on. So that's basically the mechanism. And Islamic banking promote fairness or Islamic financial system, right? Because Islamic banking is within Islamic financial system, we promote fairness, mutual access, assistance, and social responsibilities, right? Fairness in the context of rewards come with efforts, right? You cannot sit there, right? And then get money and get richer without any efforts, right? If you look at in the context, for example, right, in the context of conventional stocks, right? I give you in terms of conventional stock, in the context of stock market, for examples, right? In context of stock market. Now, if you know one of the highly traded stocks in the last 1 year or so is stock that are related to the glove, right? Those who are making glove because they are highly demanded, right? And the price have increased a lot, right? And in the Malaysian market, for example, there are once, I think these are global player in the glove. We call it as the firm name is Top Glove, right? Firm name Top Glove, right? And Top Glove declared dividends of 18 cents, right? And once shareholders in that stock, in Top Glove, for example, right, will receive dividends of 500 million just by putting money in that Top Glove. And that mechanism that make the richer to become richer, that the rich become richer. So in the context of Islamic financial system, right, through the whole integrated Islamic financial system, right, we try to provide fairness, right? Because in any the wealth of any individuals that have been entrusted of any to in any individual, the portion of it doesn't belong to that individual. The portion of it belongs to society in the form of Zakat, for example, right? So once you have a whole integrated systems, once someone get or build up the wealth, the whole society can share according to whatever is prescribed portions by the Sharia. So Islamic banking or Islamic financial system promote fairness and mitigation of harms, right? Because in a lot of things I'm not going to go through because these are quite high little bit when it comes to what I term as financial accelerator effects, but really simple form, in any Islamic financial transactions, right, there must not be harms that can inflict on society. For example, the environmental pollutions, for example, Islamic financing should not finance activities that can bring basically pollution to society. And so that's what we term as mitigation of harms. And Islamic banking are the mechanism for all these three, right? All these three. That without having to refer to, for example, SDG, right? From the beginning, when the scholars have set up the model Islamic banking or the model Islamic finance, they have all these three functions, right? So Islamic banking from the beginnings is basically try to promote inclusive growth, right? So that's what we have in the context of the banking, right? Now, disruptions come into place. We have Industry Revolution 4.0, right? And now we are 4.0. We look at, right, 1800s, we have Industry 1.0, where we have mechanizations and the introductions of steam and water power, right? Where at that time, say, basically, you have trains that are powered by steams, and that allow people to ship or to transport goods, right, from the inland to the ports and so on, and that have promoted growth, right? And then we have assembly line Industry 2.0 that in the 1900s at the beginnings, we have that. In 1970s, we start having a digital process to take place, automated productions, computers come into play, IT system come into place. We have robotics starting from 1970s or perhaps early than that. And now we have Industry 4.0, where we have basically cyberspace that take place as a platform for the exchanges, right? And if you look at Industry 4.0 creates disruptions, right? In the context that if you look and you think carefully, for example, you can build firms without having buildings, right? You don't need to have building to build firms. Or if you have building, you can build billions worth of firms, but with very small building, right? Which means that we don't look at physical building anymore because everything takes place in cyberspace. Just look at Kojak. In here, you have Grabs. There also, you have Grab, for example, right? And you have Airbnb, right? So those are type of things are coming from Industry 4.0. Now you have a lot of things, machine learning, big data, Internet of Things, and so on. Right? There are a lot of things coming up right now, and many industries, many firms are rushed towards basically IR 4.0, right? Especially the Internet of Things, a very interesting concepts, and so on. Right? So these are Industry 4.0 that have disrupted the whole process, right? The whole process, where if we do not embrace it, we are going to be left behind. Right? And in fact, we look at the pandemic, for example, right? The industry or the firms that are ready with digitalizations tend to perform better as compared to those firms that have not prepared themselves for digitalizations. Right? So that disruption has been brought by Industry 4.0. And this disruption also will be in the context of banking. Okay? So that what have taken place in terms of Industrial Revolution 4.0. Just to give you a little bit in the context of Industry 4.0, you have Industrial Internet of Things, network-centric right now. And you have a lot of apps coming up. Right? Everything can be completed within the apps. Right? And safety, cybersecurity now become a big problem in the context of digitalizations. You have automations, you have monitoring tools, right? If you look at in the context of Internet of Things, for example, right, I have seen a lot of things that have taken place in many different areas, and I would say exactly the same thing in banking. You look in terms of farming or agriculture, for example, right? They have installed automation, Internet of Things, and so on, where the drone and the machines, for example, can check the whether the fruits is basically is ready to be picked up or not. They can measure the size, right? And everything's done by the robots and so on a lens so big and so vast and so on. Okay? So these are the type of things that we have to look at, right, in the context of disruption that has been brought into the picture right now. Okay? So something is, I would say, cannot be avoided, inevitable in the context of Industry 4.0. And as I mentioned, digital banking is something that or the institution that we are looking forward to. For example, Malaysia have opened up licenses for digital banking, right? There are many firms form partnership together and try to basically apply for digital banking. One of our banks, RHB, for example, Rashid Hussein Bank, have formed a partnership with one IT firm and apply for digital banking. And the same thing, banks, Islam Malaysia Berhad now preparing platform to adopt digital banking, right? And digital banking in Singapore, Get Rails, Hong Kong, for example, right, and in Indonesia, for example, a guideline for digital bank, as I mentioned, to be released by mid-year. Maybe you know, it may have been released, right? And these are documents that good for us to read as students of banking, right? Because students of Islamic banking, we have to read everything, and not only for Islamic banking, but also for banks in general, because Islamic banking is operating under the environments of everything, right? The guideline provided by the government and the guideline govern both Islamic banking and conventional banking. So these are digital banking that come into the picture, right? Now, when I look at the challenges with the promise of Islamic banking and disruption that come into play, right? The first thing that I see in terms of this context, digital platform or digitalizations or digital banking, or even you want to call IR 4.0, right? Virtual banking, or whatever term that you want to put in, right? And then we have disruptions from the pandemic that have accelerated the digital banking, right? And I think I have not gone to the banks I have not gone to the bank counters basically. I think for many years, because everything can take place virtually. Trading in the stocks, for example, virtually taking place at the convenience of my own homes, right? Trading Sharia stocks and transferring overseas, right? For example, which cannot be done before, right? I can transfer to overseas basically the money easily, virtually. A lot of things can be done. Pay all kinds of bills just as a stroke of one punch at the computers and so on. So these are basically and in Malaysian context, the good player in this digital bank is Maybank. Maybanks. They provide all kinds of platforms they can use with all kinds of apps, right? And in terms of payments now, cashless payments and so on, right? Just take your handphones. I think the same thing have taken place in the context of Indonesia, right? And now also the same thing, I would expect that Zakat also you can pay through digital or through online virtually. So a lot of things have been on digital banking. So the first challenges that I see here is not so much of challenges, but these are opportunity where the disruption by the pandemic here can provide opportunity for Islamic financial system to look at the systems, right, in a holistic manner and try to link them together, right? So it's basically the challenges that I have, and I put also opportunities here, right? The need to integrate all components of Islamic finance, right? You have to integrate all components, which means all players have to come together in the context of channeling funds, because the funds in Islamic financial systems then should not be restricted to channel from those who have excess fund to those who are needing of the funds for the purpose of investment or consumptions and so on, but also to channel funds in the form of social assistance from all players in Islamic financial system to those who are in need without any expectations of returns. Right? And in Malaysia, for example, we are discussing quite frequently on the welfare of the B40. Those are at the bottom 40% of the income level, for example, and these people are hit hard, right? And if you look at in the context of assistance, for example, tracking the assistance, monitoring assistance, without these digitalizations, what would happen? There are duplications. One person, if you look at in the context, very easy. We have a lot of Islamic social finance institutions. We have the one that done by the NGO, right? Non-governmental organization, the one that have been basically carried out by Zakat institutions, the one that has been carried out by any established government link religious institutions, the one that has been carried out by basically the Awqaf institution and so on. But without these digitizations, there are duplication in the sense that one person may receive assistance from various sources, right? So that's why these are opportunities for us to look into building up the whole digital space that link everyone together. Perhaps I think the word that people use right now, the buzzword blockchain, for example, in order to see the flow of funds, not only between firms and banks, but also between bank, Zakat institutions, and how to trace those funds, whether they really go into basically the needy, those who are in need or not, right? Now, one study that has been done by the World Bank, for example, far, far back, in terms of the financial assistance by the World Bank to Pakistan, one village in Pakistan. And the finding of that study, I think 30, 40 years back, the finding of that study is that for every $1 given to Pakistan, less than 10 cents reach that village, right? You look at, there are a lot of leakages, right? A lot of leakages. Now, if Islamic finance or Islamic banking doesn't adopt digital bank platform, doesn't adopt digitalizations, this problem will surely take place. Where the financial system to the poor, for example, you may have seen linkages, right? Of course, this is Islamic, but then we have to be careful, because even in Islamic financial systems, bad thing can happen, right? To ensure transparency and so on, the challenges for Islamic banking is to quickly adopt the digitalization platform, right? so that we can see the flow of funds and benefits and so on. Okay? So these are very important part in the context of Islamic banking have to be developed not on its own and not to be the very dominant player, but developed and integrated into other part of Islamic financial systems, especially Islamic social financial institutions. Right? That one very important. I know the effort have taken place, right? For example, in Malaysia, for example, banks have their own zakat funds, banks have their own awqaf funds and so on, have taken place, right? But then, as I said, if everyone try to do the same thing, there will be duplication of efforts or there will be duplications of benefits where only certain individual can get benefits. But if you build up the whole integrated system, then we can see the flow of funds, right? Because you can see verifications, you have transparency and so on, right? So these are kind of big idea, but then it's something that we have to work slowly, because if our mission is basically that to make Islam to be established on this earth again, right, for example, and because our area in Islamic banking finance, right, we should put efforts, right, to realize the missions of Islamic banking that has been set as a foundation by our Islamic thinkers in the past, the early Islamic thinkers, right? And the other challenge that I can see in the context of Islamic banking here would be how ready Islamic banking, right? And I would say that at present, the readiness of Islamic bank in adopting is still not at par with conventional banks yet, right? And in Malaysian context, for example, we are basically fortunate in the context of all domestics, conventional bank have Islamic subsidiaries, right? Have Islamic subsidiaries where Islamic subsidiaries can leverage on the technology of conventional banks, right? So they can offer that. But then overall, when you look at in terms of the practices that I see, because I have both accounts, I have all accounts in Islamic bank, but then with full-fledged Islamic banks in terms of digital platform, it's not there yet as compared to, for example, the Maybank, right? So these are the challenges in the context of readiness, right? And I think I read one article that has been done on Indonesia on readiness, right? They said that readiness on one aspect is at the level of one, so it's very low readiness in the context of Islamic banking digitalizations. And that aspect, I forgot which aspect, level 3. So it's not fully ready yet in terms of adopting digitalizations, right? And then more importance now, the risk assessment become more complex. And that the challenges, right? And think in the working papers released by the IMF a few years back, have identified various challenges regarding risk of Islamic banking, because Islamic banking is not without risk. It has its own unit risk in addition to the risk that commonly faced by all banks. And now you have digitalizations, the risk of cybersecurity, right? And Sharia non-compliant risk, for example, can be magnified as a result of the digitalizations if we are not ready, right? And these are not related, the final one, it's not related to the digitalizations, but very important in context of future challenges, future role of Islamic bank, is the synergies between ESG and Islamic finance, right? If you look at ESG, means promoting environmental, social, and governance frameworks, right? So basically, the ESG is a big thing, right? Now, if you look at in Islamic finance right now, right? ESG is not part of the criteria for a firm to be in Islamic banking. I give you the example of Top Glove, right? And Top Glove came into the picture and under the spotlight. Why? Because of forced labor, forced labor. But Top Glove is Islamic compliance, but they are not ESG compliance, right? So those aspects have not been integrated yet within Islamic finance. And moving forward, basically, the challenges that Islamic banking have to fulfill is to incorporate ESG, right? ESG into its frameworks, right? So it's Islamic finance have to go beyond negative exclusions, right? Because sometimes we just use financial ratio, right? But then we have also need to look at whether the Islamic finance can bring positive social and environmental impacts. So those are all the challenges. And as I mentioned before, I may not be able to do justice in giving all the challenges, right? But these are just general presentation that I have, right? Digitalizations cannot be avoided. Inevitables, right? Is Islamic Bank ready, right? Not only to adopt digitalizations, but then also to develop itself in linking the business institutions and social institutions that can, that not only promoting growth, right, but also provide fairness in terms of distribution of income and doesn't bring harm to society. So that the inclusive growth, which the final word I would like to say, that word inclusive growth is the ultimate challenge of Islamic financial system in the era of digitalizations. And Dr. Dimas, thank you for the opportunity. I think I'm not sure whether more than 1 hour or within 1 hour. I think roughly a little bit less than 1 hour what we have done. But thank you again for inviting me and on to talk about these very important topics. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dr. Dimas, ya.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi. Ya, waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi for enlightening us for the role of Islamic banking and how Islamic banking deals with the current disruptive era in the midst of the growth of financial technology. Okay, Prof. We have around 40. More than 15 minutes to have a.
It's breaking up. I cannot hear you. Yeah, I cannot hear you. Breaking up.
Prof. Yeah, so please. Okay. Okay, dear participants, we have around 40 minutes to have a question and answer sessions. Please, if you have some questions or comment, feedback regarding with what Professor Masroor just now presented, please. Or you just write your question in the chat if you don't want to ask directly. Please, participants, if you have some questions. Okay, meanwhile, waiting the question from participant, Prof. I have here a question a bit about the how to make the integration between the Islamic banking and finance with the current development of fintechs. In Indonesia right now, by the way, the government has already taken very serious efforts by promoting the regulations. And also by establishing some institution that connecting with the Islamic banking and finance. So according to your experience, Prof, and your humble knowledge, what kind of regulation in reality, Prof, in practical, that can make this integration of Islamic banking and finance into the fintech development smoothly done, Prof? I mean that, you see that if we don't have credible regulations, maybe the dilemma between the development of fintech and Islamic banking will be happens. If we promote the fintech, maybe the Islamic banking will be far behind because the competition become more tight. But if we don't have regulations, then Islamic banking and finance don't have strong reference out how to make this inclusive growth that you mean just now become sustainable. So could you please just, Prof, give the maybe more clear what kind of regulation that Islamic Bank really needs in dealing with this digital era, Prof?
Okay, very, very difficult questions, right? Because myself is not so well versed in the context of the area of regulations, right? Because in terms of banking itself, there are various regulations that are at play, right? And basically, people are still discussing, for example, in the context of Islamic banking, right? How it would impact on Islamic banking. And now comes again the digitalization, right, of digital banking, right? And I think in terms of regulations, these are the area of regulators that they have to, right? The most important parts in context of digital banking, I would say, related to cybersecurity, most important parts, right? Because if you look at in the context of digital platforms, right, and try to link with basically digital currency and so on, everything in digital space, right, monitoring would not be easy, right, in terms of monitoring and transactions and so on. So those are the area that I would say that regulators have to look at in terms of developing what we term as digital banking, right? And since I would say that the establishments cannot be developed independently from each other, right? So which basically regulator must come into the picture and play the roles in the integration process. It cannot be done by the whole systems, right, will not be complete, and it will not be able to perform its full function if, for example, let's say Bank Islam Malaysia Berhad work with the state government of Selangor in the context of integrating the Zakat or Awqaf institutions under the state government of Selangor with the Islamic Bank, right? So you just create segmented. So basically, regulations have to provide certain platforms in holistic manner in terms of incorporating all players together, right? So I'm not sure, I just put a lot of thinking here in the context of regulation, but then the challenge, if we want to put in here, is the same thing as what we are facing right now, because once regulations are in place, normally those are applied for both Islamic banking and conventional banking. The same thing with Basel III, for example, right? Islamic banking, conventional banking, both face requirements from Basel III, but then, right, Islamic banking, right, and conventional banking, in principles, I have to emphasize here, in principles, they are not the same. Right? And I believe they are not the same because they are guided by different principles. Right? So that basically the challenge that has been put in place, right? So for me, I'm not looking, the regulations are there, but then more important, how to basically put those regulations and have one body that try to look at in terms of integrating Islamic banking within the whole system that we have here, right? And I know that my very good friend, Prof. Kabir, also here. Thank you, Prof. Kabir, that you're here. That he's even more our guru in Islamic banking and finance, right? I think the top cited, the scholar in Islamic banking and finance. Okay. Assalamu alaikum, Prof. Kabir.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Mansur. Prof. Kabir, are you there, Prof. Kabir? Could you please just maybe respond or give just a bit talk, Prof. Kabir? Assalamualaikum, Prof. Kabir. Are you there? Are you still with us, Prof. Kabir? Okay, I think he's not around. Okay, thank you, Prof. Mansur, for giving us the answer. And the next one, maybe the participants, you have any comments or questions, or just write in the chat if you don't want to ask directly to Prof. Please, dear participants and students. And here also we have Dr. Samidi, Prof, from KNKS, If I can greet you, Dr. From KNKS.
Assalamualaikum.
Are you there? Okay, any questions, participants? Please. Okay, maybe Prof, meanwhile waiting for the question from audience as well, do you have also maybe the research topic in mind, Prof, regarding with this area that maybe here the participant can think of it and then can promote this idea to be more practical and more applicable and then come up with the kind of regulation or policy making, Prof. Maybe you have some idea in mind, Prof. What should be the area of research that could be done, Prof.
Okay, thanks. Now, the area that I'm looking at right now, I just can inform you my interest that I have, and my interest mostly in Islamic banking, right? Islamic banking now, and it's more of I would say academic exercise that I have done, but I would say that would have potentials implications, right? Would have potential implications in the context of policy design. I would say in that context, right? Because I'm interested a lot right now in looking at basically, the one that I have just mentioned there, the financial inclusions, the importance of, let me just write there, the financial inclusions, right? So that's the area that I'm looking at, right? Now, because I would try to make assessments right now in various aspects, right? Because I'm more looking at Islamic banking as well as the normal financial economics, right? So I look at financial inclusions, right? Now, when I look at the debates on financial inclusions, for example, right? What have raised or what have incited me in the context of to understand deeper the benefits of financial inclusions? Because if you look at that, a lot of discussion has been done, right? And a lot of, because in within the practical circle, within the practices, among practitioners, for example, among the researchers or among scholars, they have discussed in the context of financial inclusions. And basically, they mentioned that Islamic finance, right? As I mentioned here, one of the objectives, Islamic finance can promote financial inclusions. Right, so that's what has been said. Right? Now, but my interest that I try to look at, right, is into dimensions of financial inclusion. So of course, these are not something easy because data is not there. But then I try to look at dimensions of financial inclusions, right? And I also am also interested in the context of the contributions of financial inclusions during difficult times. Right, during difficult time. So because in good time, for example, financial inclusions may work, right? For example, in helping equalizing income distributions, for example, because you are in good times, right? During the expansions, for example, everyone will get benefits. And once everyone are financially included, they also will basically benefit from whatever the growth that have taken place in good time. How about in difficult times, right? How about in difficult times, right? So I try to assess in terms of the characteristic of financial inclusions, right? In context of basically, because the most important parts of the banking system when we look at is basically resilience, right? The most important part, resilience, even in tough times, right? So does financial inclusions promote resilience, right? So these are thing that I try to look at. So more of academic exercise that I try to look at, because at the end, I would try to see that in the context of what we see so far, financial inclusions, whether they make banks or they make the economy to be more resilience, right? And by identifying these dimensions. Now, we have discussed today digital dimensions of financial inclusion, for example, right? And more data, more and more data coming up. I think few of the work has been done on digital inclusion, for example. And those will provide some indications, some guidelines of where we have to look at, right? Because not all type of inclusions may bring benefits in difficult times. So those are the type of things that we have to look at, because we have to build a framework that are adaptive enough to be able to identify which aspect of financial inclusions, either it be digital inclusions, credit inclusions, deposit inclusions, or whatever type of inclusion we want to name it, right? We'll basically promote the resilience of the economic system or of the financial system, for example. So those are quite important parts. And how is like finance come into play, right? So in promoting resilience, right? I'm not sure whether this will be a good project for the undergraduate or not, but then I think it will be a good project, because few of my students now are looking at financial inclusions and various dimensions of financial inclusion and try to look at various aspects. So those are something that I'm looking right now in the context of evaluating carefully the notions of financial inclusion. Yes, many work has been done. Many work have noted the benefits, but then we have to look carefully because if you look at before, right, the IMF and the World Bank come with all kinds of recommendations. We adopt recommendation by the World Bank, but as time proceeds, we see the limitation of those recommendations, right? Even financial system, right? We develop our financial system, now we see the risk in financial system. That financial system itself can be a factor that negatively affect growth, right? So those are the type of things that that I look at. So my apology, you asked in terms of research areas, but these are something that financial inclusions and how best to design the framework for financial inclusions when you have Islamic banking.
Thank you, Prof, for your explanations. Basically, your concerns quite a bit same with my concern, Prof. Because right now I'm also doing research in the area of resilience, Islamic banking. So I'm looking at the factors, the component, how to develop the framework to develop the resilient Islamic banking. But resilience here is the basic the ways how to promote the stability. So here I'm working with the indexation right now, Prof. We're looking at the index, developing the indexation, and then use this indexation as surveillance tools in order to look at the risk assessments. And of course, the assessment also based on the several indicators in the form of composite index as well. So in the end, we are looking at the optimal balance, Prof, optimal resilient level, so that to what extent the resilient can be achieved and what is the resilient level, so that by finding this resilient level, we can estimate what is the position of the current Islamic banking operations in terms of the how Islamic banking also adopt and adapt with the vulnerability condition and then the shock conditions, so that we can come up with the policy recommendation then to what extent the macroeconomic variables can move or move up on or down in order to maintain this resilient level. So exactly what you think, Prof, what I'm thinking now, basically we can maybe work together in the future, Prof.
If you look at, for example, the research in Islamic banking, for example, you want to look at early years of research Islamic banking, we just focus on Sharia principles, right? We try to develop the framework. Those are the early years, right? Sharia framework for Islamic banking, right? People look at, and then people start making comparisons, right? So comparative analysis, right? Where the early years, people comparative analysis mainly of financial ratio of Islamic banking and conventional bank. So they look at mainly efficiency in terms of early years. Because the arguments coming up, because Sharia framework impose extra cost, because you have extra layer and so on. So people focus on comparative analysis. And then more and more comparison has been made, right? There are heightened comparison here. But then the dimensions of comparison that people make are more. People not only look at efficiency, people look at how Islamic Bank functions even in the transmission of monetary policy as compared to conventional bank. So those are comparisons that has been made, right? And then I would say that the next step, after we have done comparisons, we have to develop literature on Islamic Bank on its own. And one area that we have to look at is in terms of the contributions, right? So we have to start assessing the contributions. If Islamic banking really basically abide by the Sharia framework, do they result in or do they contribute according to what they are supposed to contribute in terms of a term as inclusive growth? That, but there are many dimensions that you can take a look at. So which means that we have to build a framework of Islamic banking on its own and how it's related to the economy without having to make reference to conventional banking. So that's why I said these are part, right? And a lot of things are added now with the pandemics, with the digitalizations, with basically regulation of Islamic banking, and with a lot of things that have taken place, for example, right, where we can develop Islamic banking as a separate field, but then departing from just merely making comparisons, right? Because I think we have done a lot of comparisons so far, right? And have written a lot of quite few papers on comparisons, but now we have to assess contributions. The good thing is that when we assess contribution and try to look at various dimension elements, if you have not contributed to what Islamic banking is supposed to contribute, we can take a look back at the framework. Can we modify the framework so that it can achieve the objective? So the whole process, we have to have intention to improve Islamic banking so that it can contribute or it can fulfill whatever the intended objective that we have laid down, right, from the beginning. Right? So those are the type of things that I would say in terms of research in Islamic banking. Right? Islamic capital market, I'm not so well versed, but then I'm very interested in Islamic banking because a lot of people are looking at right on Islamic banking. I think the number of papers coming out the most is Islamic banking, right? So it become more and more congested, but then still a room for us to try to take a look at. For example, you mentioned about regulations. A lot of things still need to be done with respect to regulation and so on.
Thank you, Prof, for your enlightening presentations. Okay, dear students and participants, I think Prof Mansoori here has provoking you with some issues with Islamic banking and finance research. I think it is time for you to later on extend in your research, in your thesis, in your undergraduate thesis in the future. And also you can also being, maybe you can be inspired by Prof Mansoori in order to how to make our Islamic banking is more sustainable, yeah, not only in terms of the Sharia regulation, but also in terms of the operational and economic operational, and also how to integrate Islamic banking with the social activities, yeah, or social finance, so that the integration here can promote Islamic banking to be more inclusive, Prof. Mansoori mentioned just now, and more resilience, and also in the end, will give more contributions to the economic of the Ummah, inshallah. Sure. Okay, dear student and friends, do you have any questions or comments, feedback, before we end the sessions, please? Okay, I think the student here,
yeah. Yes, yeah, Dr. Dimas, I just want to mention a little bit. I think if you are interested, for example, to further your study at the master or PhD levels, I think please consider INSEF as one of your institutions, because there are many different institutions that are offering.
Yeah.
Even Indonesia is coming up with a lot of programs right now with the establishments of its own Islamic finance university, for example. But then the INSEF also one of the players. We have few Indonesians studying with us right now, mostly in PhD and master, right? So we do provide full scholarship, but very competitive for the PhD. And I think we have one from Indonesia that are doing PhD with full scholarships. He's with with one of the institutions, I forgot, Aukaf institutions or Zakat institution in Indonesia, right? But he's doing right now. And for the master, we have president scholarship which will cover all the tuition fees, right? So those are what we have in terms of the scholarship. We don't have a lot, but then if you are interested to diversify in terms of learning more, not only Indonesia, but coming to Malaysia for master. And then for example, PhD go to UK to learn from our good guru or good scholars in Durham, for example, right? So these are the network of Islamic banking finance worldwide. So those are type. Thank you again, Dr. Dimas, for the opportunity.
Yeah.
And thank you to all of you for being so nice not to ask me anything except Dr. Dimas. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, dear students and friends, we have just now discussed with Prof. Mansur regarding with the challenges of the Islamic banking in the digital era. And from Prof. Mansur, we have got some important points here that we cannot avoid the growth of the digital era for the Islamic in the Islamic banking and finance. But the thing that the Islamic banking and finance must do is to more active to promote his role by considering the risk assessment, for example, and cybersecurity, for example, and then how to make the Islamic banking is more resilient in the midst of current a pandemic, for example, and the current progressive growth of the digital technology. And in the end, Prof. Mansur suggested that the Islamic banking must be more inclusive, yeah, must be more resilient, and then integrated with the social finance, so that in the end, Islamic banking and finance will be more sustained and more sustainable, when more prosperity will give more prosperity, and then in the end will more benefiting the ummah or the society at large. That's all from me. Thank you again, Prof, for your valuable time, Prof Mansur, and hopefully we can extend our communication, our collaborations, and then our discussions. Yeah, and then hopefully one day we can meet physically, Prof, again in Malaysia, inshallah, or in Indonesia, and yeah, stay safe and help, yeah, Prof, there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, send my salam to everyone, because I saw the video, Dr. Rizal, Prof Rizal there.
Oh,
and then, Prof Adnan there, right?
Yeah.
The video too.
Ahyar so Adnan. Yeah.
Ahyar Adnan. Yeah. So
yeah.
So that's how we together in UAE before. So send salam to everyone, to all friends there. Inshallah,
Prof. Okay, with that, let me end this session with reciting Alhamdulillah together. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin. Thank you very much. Stay safe and health. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Prof.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you.